SRPC. It is so good to see you this morning. Welcome. Come on in if you're still out in the foyer, and we're going to worship this morning. Welcome to those of you who are joining us online. We are so glad to have you, and it is always a good day to worship the Lord. So I've got a few announcements for us. First of all, every Sunday, Donuts and Debrief. We're going to do that downstairs, and we've got some special guests, so you won't want to miss them. So come on downstairs after church this morning, and you know, in person, come on downstairs. It's a good place to be. Next up, Trunk or Treat. That is a good time. And so if you know kids, if you have kids, if you've seen kids, invite them to Trunk or Treat. It's going to be a fun time. We only need 8 more cars. So I think we can do that. Come on, SRPC. Let's rally. We only need 8 more cars. So let's make that happen to bless our community. And next, I have Building Bridges. As you can see, we have a Building Bridges theme going this week. And John, come on up. I think he's going to give us some information about building bridges. Yeah, John.
Thank you, Beth. Well, after loving Jesus and loving one another, we at SRPC want to be known by our community for our love. Building Bridges is a catalyst for loving our community through servanthood. It creates new connections and it nourishes existing ones. And Building Bridges is also a retreat to reflect on how Jesus serves us through serving others. So the 22nd annual Building Bridges is happening this coming Saturday. And who we serve are the overwhelmed elderly, widows, veteran homes. The type of work that we do are general cleanup. We have, I'm sorry, I'm not a morning person. Overgrowth cleanup, minor repairs, gutter cleaning. We have low skill to no skill projects. We have, let's see here, welcoming all servants from all ages. We have team leaders who will guide projects, who will put people in pairs and guide them through the tasks to completion. And all of this starts next Saturday. So we also have lunches that we provided, and we have a welcome, wonderful welcome celebration dinner at the end of the day. The day works out such as we have 8 o'clock here, we meet for breakfast. From 8 to 9, we go through the tool distribution and instructions, and after that we send out everyone out for the field projects, and after the field projects are completed, we're all back here by 4:30 to 6:30 for this wonderful dinner. I'd like to close with one of my favorite Steve Leal quotes, and Steve says, building bridges is an opportunity to be and live the dream by being the hands and feet of Jesus in our community to serve others. So God bless Steve for that quote, and God bless you all. We need signups. We can sign up at the table seeing Diane and Ed Thompson in the back after the service. We have a QR code here on the program, and then we also have signups online directly. We need about 20 more people, so we invite you to sign up and invite a friend, and thank you very much.
Awesome. That is fantastic. Thanks, John. I wanted to just mention that Trunk or Treat is October 26th, so you've got a couple more weeks to make that happen for those 8 more cars. And then lastly, October 27th, the day after Trunk or Treat, is Pastor Appreciation Sunday. So if you would like to bring a card, bring a note of appreciation that Sunday for all three of our pastors, that would be awesome. And then right now, would you stand if you are able? We are going to do a responsive reading. And you'll see there's a leader part, and then there's an all part, and you all are the all. So let's bring it. This is taken from Psalm 111, verses 7 through 10. All he does is just and good, and all his commandments are trustworthy. They are forever true, to be obeyed faithfully with integrity. has paid a full ransom for his people. He has guaranteed his covenant with them forever. What a holy, awe-inspiring name he has. Fear of the Lord is the foundation of true wisdom. All who obey his commandments will grow in wisdom. Praise him forever. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you for your enduring love. God, we invite you into this place. May what we do and say and hear today bless you, bless each other, and bring renew and restoration to our hearts. God, we give you all the glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hope you are ready to worship with us this morning. We're talking about all that Jesus has done for us, and we're thanking God. Would you join us together?
Me. I've been held in your hands from the moment that I wake up until I lay my head. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Everything to him, and that is because he is good. He is pure. He is perfect in all the ways that he deals with us, the things that he does for us, the way he makes plans for us. It's because he is holy. Would you join me and the angels and sing that to him this morning?
The highest, your Of our service, when we give our offering, it is our response and faithfulness to say, we are giving from what you have already given. And on the screen, there is many different ways you can give, but this is an act of worship. So would you pray with me as we continue our worship in this way? Heavenly Father, we worship you, our holy God. And we give back to you, to honor you, to bless you, to further your kingdom. And we do it joyously. So Lord, take what we can give and use it. Spread your word, your message, to build your kingdom here in San Ramon and in the valley, Lord, and through all areas on this planet. To you be the glory. To you, our holy God, we worship. Be seated, and at this time, dismiss the kids for kids' church. And we also have some special guests with us. We have our missions partners, Dave and Wendy, and I invite you to come, and they will share briefly with us. And also, they will be with us for donuts and debrief. And I encourage you to hang out afterwards if you're able to. Thank you, Dave, Wendy.
Thank you, Ken. Good morning. Well, the last time we were here to see you was in 2019, 5 years. Okay, there was this thing called COVID in the middle. That's what kept us from coming to you. We usually come and see you every 3 years or so. The short story is we are still doing the same thing, which is member care to missionaries, caring for missionaries on the field, so that nothing brings them back besides the Lord. David is a clinical counselor. I do spiritual formation, spiritual direction, mentoring, prayer, whatever needs done. At the end of May last year, the Lord began to move through our families. We both have aging parents. My father has Alzheimer's, his mother has Alzheimer's. Our oldest daughter, Ruthie, and her husband have started a family. Our younger daughter, Amber, and her Brazilian husband, after a three-year wait, are finally getting a green card, and they will be back in December, so we felt a shift. The Lord has reestablished our base in Colorado Springs. We're doing 2 months of the year in Chiang Mai, 10 months in Colorado Springs, the same ministry, loving on missionaries. Please come to Donuts, Donuts First, and debrief after the service to hear more. And we have a table in the back with new prayer cards and a sign-up sheet.
Don't go anywhere. Sarah here. Sarah here. We'd just like to take a moment and pray with you.
Oh, thank you.
And if you would like to come and lay hands on them, I invite you to come forward. And if you were remaining in your seat, if you would just take a chance and just reach out your hand and for them as an act of laying on hands. Heavenly Father, the work that these two do, the work that you have called them to, is so important, so good, and I pray that you would continue to have your hand of blessing upon them. Give them wisdom, insight, discernment on how to help those who are on the field to stay on the field. Help marriages to stay strong, families to stay together, and to help guide through issues that occur when it is really hard in a different culture. So Lord, give them, use them, and bless them. Lord, we ask this over them in the name of Jesus. All God's people said, amen. Amen. I can tell you firsthand what they do, how important it is, because I used to be on the field myself, and I know, and I have tapped into people just like them who do the same thing. And you know, when our family first moved to China, it was a difficult transition, and my team leader gave an analogy of what it's like to help us describe what we are feeling. And she said to picture a magician standing there before this table with the white tablecloth. You know, you've seen this trick. And the magician smiles real big and grabs a hold of this tablecloth. And then, but instead of everything staying perfectly in its place, everything comes crashing to the floor. And everything is a mess. All the items are now just scattered about. And it's a mess. But her point was moving to a new country, you know, you have to start over. And it's hard. And this is an opportunity to reset your table. And even though it is hard, it can be scary, it gives you the chance to re-examine what matters most. To realign your priorities, to set the table the way you want it to look, and to set those new rhythms and patterns in life in place in a way that this new life of yours will honor God. And that's where we find the Israelites today. They're about to enter into a new land, and being given a chance to realign their values. This is where they get to push that reset button. And we're in Joshua chapter 5 this morning. So if you have that, I encourage you to take your Bible and open it up. The words are on your screen. If you're using your phone, I use the NLT if you want to follow along with the exact translation. Starting in Joshua chapter 5 in verse 2. At that time, the Lord told Joshua, "Make flint knives and circumcise the second generation of Israelites. So Joshua made flint knives and circumcised the entire male population of Israel at Gibeath Haaraloth. So in chapter 1, the troops were all rallied. You know, it is time to take the land that they have been given. And in chapter 3, God's hand moves in a powerful way. And the Jordan River splits or stops flowing. And at this point, they have to be really pumped. I mean, that nervous energy, that excitement, that adrenaline that's just flowing. And then in chapter 4, they're like, okay, we're going to take a pause. And we got to remember what God did, and we're going to honor him. And they built the monument, check. But now we're ready. Let's do this thing. And I picture this like the battle scene from Braveheart, where Joshua gathers his troops, and he stands before them, and he says, Men, God is on our side. He has given us this land. There is no king who is stronger than our God. There is no army bigger than our God, and there's nothing out there fiercer than our God. You saw what he did to the Jordan River, and they saw what he did to the Jordan River, and they are terrified. And I can just picture, you know, all these men like, yeah, you know, they're erupting in cheer and they're excited. It's like a coach that is talking to his team before the big game, like the coach revving up his team before the World Cup championship. And I can picture them just all fired up and ready to go. And he says, are you ready to do what the Lord has called us to do? And they yell, yeah. Are you ready to take the land God has given us? Yeah. And then Joshua says, but there is one thing we need to do first. And he raises this little flint knife in the air. And he tells them what needs to happen. And I can see them like, and I think every male from that time, and every male in this time, and every male in between can understand that this is not going to be a very pleasant thing. Because it's a sharpened rock. No anesthetics, no frozen bag of peas for recovery, no thank you. You know, I can't imagine any person saying, I would like to volunteer first for this. And there is no Guinness World Record for the most circumcisions done in a day. But let's go ahead and give that honorary title to Joshua. And we don't know how many days it took or if he recruited other men to help him. Now, I assume just based on the sheer number of people he had to recruit people to help. Are you ready to do what the Lord has called us to do? Sometimes it takes a painful sacrifice. Verse 4. Joshua had to circumcise them because all the men who were old enough to fight in battle when they left Egypt had died in the wilderness. Those who left Egypt had all been circumcised, but none of those born after the Exodus during the years in the wilderness had been circumcised. The Israelites had traveled in the wilderness for 40 years until all the men who were old enough to fight in a battle when they left Egypt had died, for they had disobeyed the Lord, and the Lord vowed he would not let them enter the land he had sworn to give us, a land flowing with milk and honey. So Joshua circumcised their sons, those who had grown up to take the place of their fathers, for they had not been circumcised on the way to the promised land. And after all the males had been circumcised, they rested in camp until they were healed. So according to Mosaic law, you had to be 20 years old to enter into the military. And everyone who was 20 years or older when they left Egypt, they are now dead. And every male between 41 and 59, well, they had already been circumcised. But everyone who was 40 years or younger Well, it's your turn. You got to get in line. And strategically, this is a terrible plan. I mean, God just showed his power. The kings in the nearby towns, they are scared out of their minds. This is the time to attack. I mean, you strike when the iron is hot, but Joshua is commanded to disable his troops for a few days. Why? Because the Israelites needed to realign their priorities. During their desert wanderings, the nation had neglected two important areas of the Mosaic Law. The first was circumcision. Now, this is a fairly standard medical procedure for males born in America. There's no religious significance to it. It's a routine hygienic practice. But for the Israelites, it held high religious significance. Because on the eighth day after a male was born, it was required for them to be circumcised. The circumcision was this physical sign that this child was part of the family of God. This marked them as Jewish. This was an initiation rite to enter the covenant that was established by Abraham. Now, a covenant is a legally binding agreement, and it is stronger than a promise. It's more like a contract. So think of it like this. I recently signed many legal agreements when I sold my house in Wichita. The buyer and I had to come to terms, agree on terms, finances, conditions, you know, those types of things. And when we both signed the final agreement, payment was transferred. They took possession of the house. The house belongs to them. I no longer have any legal right or claim to this house. So you understand this type of contract in modern-day terms is I agree, we come together. And it's like when I stood before you at the end of your August congregational meeting. It was Mike Goldsmith who extended to me, hey, we want you to be your senior pastor. And it is I who enthusiastically said, yes! And at that point, we entered into a covenant relationship. We are part of the same spiritual family. There are agreements that we made to each other, pastor and congregation, that will be formally solidified on November 3rd during my installation service. Now, you're going to hear more about that in the coming weeks, but it's a ceremonial procedure from our presbytery when they come in and they officially mark me as senior pastor of SRPC. Well, circumcision was the ceremonial procedure that marked males as Jewish. They entered this covenant relationship with God, but unlike an earthly contract that can be dissolved or a relationship between a pastor and congregation that can end, this covenant promise is binding forever. These people entered into a spiritual relationship with the Lord their God. It is God's selection or election of people. It is a concept repeated over and over again from Genesis to Revelation where God says, I will be your God and you will be my people. It was God's choice out of God's grace. And theologically speaking, this is referred to the covenant of grace. And we see this displayed from Adam and Eve after they sinned in the garden, and it weaves its way through the entire Old Testament, and it finds its completion in the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. And this ceremonial entrance into this covenant relationship through circumcision was required for all males before they could take part in the celebration of Passover. And we see them celebrate Passover in verse 10. When the Israelites were camped at Gilgal on the plains of Jericho, they celebrated Passover on the evening of the 14th day of the first month. The very next day, they began to eat unleavened bread and roasted grain from the land. No manna appeared on the day they first ate from the crops of the land, and it was never seen again. So from that time on, the Israelites ate from the crops of Canaan. I want you to see this. This is important. That this is the first time that they celebrated Passover in 40 years. This is also the second thing that they neglected in their desert wanderings. Passover is a yearly celebration, and it commemorates how God moved in a big way and saved them. Before they fled out of Egypt, before they fled from Pharaoh, God sent 10 plagues, and the 10th plague was that of the death of the firstborn male, all firstborn males, including animals, livestock, and humans. And in order to escape this judgment, your family had to take an animal, a goat or a lamb, and sacrifice it, and roast it and eat it. And they had to take the blood of this animal and put it on top and the sides of the doors, because the blood of this animal, sacrifice, kept them safe. And when the angel of death came to this house and saw the blood covering it, it passed over this house. And no one was harmed. And the Jews continued to celebrate Passover. You know, the first night of the festival was consisted of a meal, and they shared the story of Exodus, and they had different foods that symbolized different aspects of it. And Jesus was celebrating Passover on the night he was betrayed. It was Peter and John. They were sent ahead of time to make preparations, to find the place, to get the lamb without blemish that was roasted and eaten. There was unleavened bread during this meal, which Jesus took and he broke, and he said, "This is my body given for you." And during this meal, there were 4 cups of wine. And one of those cups of wine, Jesus, as he poured it out, he said, "This is my blood poured out for you." And we Christians don't often celebrate Passover, because we believe that God's deliverance was fulfilled in the work of Jesus. And instead, we celebrate communion, like we did last week, where we remember his body given for us and his blood shed for us. And through the accounts found in Scripture, we believe that this is a practice, communion, that Jesus himself instituted and told us to do. So we consider this a holy event or a sacrament. So ultimately, the Jewish people are given a chance here to start over, to set their table in a way that honors God moving forward, to put in place natural rhythms that allow their families to stay on track. And for them, it was circumcision and Passover. Well, how about us? Is it time for us to just hit that reset button? What rhythms do you have in your life to keep you on track, aligned with God? Do you have that consistent time where I'm going to meet with God this week, this day? I love it on Saturdays in my house when it's quiet, and I naturally just wake up early and make my coffee, and here I have quiet time right here in the Word. Do you have that time where you are meeting with other believers in small groups and growing together? Is that part of your rhythm of life? Do you have that alarm set on your cell phone, Monday, 10 a.m., time to pray for SRPC? Do you have that consistent time of prayer, connecting with God the Father? Does your story or the way your week looks show that you are devoted to the one true God? The Israelites, they needed that reminder. And so do we at times. You know, in our denomination, which is the Evangelical Presbyterian Church, it is the EPC, there are two sacraments. And the first one we mentioned was communion. And the second is baptism. Baptism is a sign or symbol of the covenant, and it is the covenant of grace which is fulfilled in Jesus. And we practice baptism as a sign of the covenant, declaring that we are part of God's family. And for us, baptism replaces circumcision. In Galatians 5:6, coming. Galatians 5:6 up here on the screen. For when we place our faith in Christ Jesus, there is no benefit in being circumcised or being uncircumcised. What is important is faith expressing itself in love. And in Colossians 2, Paul continues this. When you came to Christ, you were circumcised, but not by a physical procedure. Christ performed a spiritual circumcision, the cutting away of your sinful nature, for you were buried with Christ when you were baptized. And with him, you were raised to new life because you trusted the mighty power of God who raised Christ from the dead. Baptism is the sign that we are buried in death to our sins and raised again in life through Christ. And in this, baptism is not an act of salvation. For adults, it is the sign that they have professed faith in Christ. And they are proclaiming this publicly, that Jesus Christ is their Lord and Savior. And as Presbyterians, we also baptize infants. Again, understanding that the act of baptism is not an act of salvation. It is a continuation of this covenant rite. It is the Abrahamic covenant which extended to people of faith and their children. And in the book of Acts, when the head of the household came to faith, the entire household, including the servants and the children and the babies, were all baptized. And it showed everyone that this family had made a choice to follow Yahweh, and that their kids would grow up as followers of Jesus. It is an example that Christ has given for us. And if you are here, or if you are watching online, and you have made that profession of faith that Jesus Christ is your Lord and your Savior, you believe in his death, burial, and resurrection, but you have not taken that next step to follow through in baptism, I encourage you this week to consider that. Because I know it can be kind of scary at times, especially like I've been a believer for 30 years, but I've never been baptized. And I'm kind of embarrassed at this point that I waited so long. Don't be. Because everyone here would be like, yeah, yes. No one will look down on you for waiting. They will rejoice with you because of your faith. So if you have professed faith in Christ but have not been baptized, I encourage you to consider that and pray, God, is it time for me to be baptized? And I want to let you know that on October 27th, 2 weeks from today, we will celebrate along two families as their teen daughters will take that step of obedience through baptism. It will be a morning of rejoicing. And if you contact me or email me, talk to me, you're like, I want to do that too. We can make it 3 families, 4 families to celebrate together. We want our priorities and our families and this church's priorities, to be in faithful alignment with Jesus. The Israelites had to pause, hit that reset button before they continued on into the promised land, and they had to reestablish these covenant ceremonies. So what is God calling us to do? How do you need to reset your table today? What rhythms do we need to establish in our homes, in our church, to more faithfully follow Jesus? Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, a few weeks ago our prayer was, how can you use us? Today, we come and you ask, what do you want us to do? How can we realign our priorities to reflect them to your priorities? What can we do as individuals? And I pray, Lord, that you would, through your Spirit, reveal those things, those areas in our lives where we just need to hit that reset button. Lord, may we be in alignment with you, individually and as a church, as we move forward together. Lord, may we be aligned. Heavenly Father, show us these things. To you, forever, be the glory. Amen.
Would you stand with us, and we're going to end this morning by just remembering who God is, what he has done, and that we need him. Let's just be reminded of that this morning. I'm calling on the God of Jacob, whose love endures through generations. I know that you will keep your covenant. I'm calling on the God of Moses, the one who opened up the ocean. I need you now to do the same.
Family, I will remind you on your way out, there are opportunities to sign up for Building Bridges, all the red shirts here, and for Trunk or Treat. But I want to leave you with this from Ephesians chapter 5. Imitate God, therefore, in everything you do, because you are his dear children. Live a life filled with love, following the example of Christ. He loved us and offered himself as a sacrifice for us, a pleasing aroma to God. SRPC family, may your lives imitate God. And may the practices that you've established in them be a pleasing aroma to our Father. Go and be the church this week.